Greetings, everyone. I am James Lindsay, Senior Vice President here at the Council. It is my great pleasure on behalf of Richard Haass, the President of the Council on Foreign Relations, to welcome you to this CFR event in the opening session of the annual Hauser Symposium. Our topic this year is China's domestic evolution. We are delighted to be able to host the conference in person. And I want to welcome everybody who is in the room today, as well as people who are joining us virtually. I also would like to thank Rita Hauser, who is with us here today. Rita has supported the Council for many years. And this symposium has been made possible by the generous support and backing of the Hauser Foundation. We're going to be having three sessions today. They're going to look at China's domestic transformation and how the country's demographic trends, COVID policies, and economic development are affecting the country's rise in sustainability as a global power. I'm sure you'll agree with me. These are critical issues today. What I'd like to do now is to join me in welcoming the panelists for our first session. Its title is Demography is Fate, China's Aging Population and Declining Birth Rate. Our presider for this session is CFR member Nicholas Eberstadt. Nick is the Henry Wendt Chair in Political Economy at the American Enterprise Institute and a man who knows a lot about demography. You're in great hands. Nick, over to you.
Thank you, Jim. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to CFR Hauser Symposium. It's almost like the before times, isn't it? Back together again. It's wonderful to be back at the headquarters. And it's great to be here for this session. And welcome also to our virtual audience. As Jim said, our assigned topic this morning is Demography is Fate, China's Aging Population and Declining Birth Rate. I'll leave it to the metaphysicians among us to tell us whether demography is destiny or not. But we do know that slowly, but quite unforgivingly, population change has impacts on the realm of the possible in the social realm, economic realm, and even in the political and national security realm. And we have three experts with us who I think are going to shed a great deal of light on the constraints, opportunities, and prospects for the People's Republic of China, but also for Taiwan and other countries in the East Asian area. Not to give away the show, but since the end of the one-child policy, the People's Republic of China has seen a tremendous slump in birth levels. A continuing one that began before the COVID crisis. And this is accentuating some of the trends that we'll have to be talking about today. With us here today, we have, I think, one of the persons who would be on anybody's short list of best living student of China's population, Professor Wang Feng. Coming from Taiwan, by the magic of telecommunications, we have a rising star from academia Sinica, Alice Cheng, one of the experts on Taiwan and South Korea and other East Asian areas, super low fertility, their determinants and implications. And right here from a CFR resident fellow and Fordham law professor, Carl Minzner, who's written widely and wisely on law and policy in the People's Republic of China and the rest of East Asia. So let's start in right away. Wang Feng, you actually have written a number of books on this, so I won't say you could write a book on the question I'm going to ask you. But let's say in an elevator version, what are the things that we should know about China's population trends in the recent past? What are the big problems that they pose? What are the questions they pose for the future?
Thank you, Nick. Well, I have 5 minutes to do this, so I won't be able to get to every part. Well, demography, as Nick was saying, is a slow-moving train. But for China, I think last year or this year is another milestone. The milestone is that China effectively has ceased population growth. So we saw the early report this year. Last year, China added less than 500,000 people. So in a country of 1.4 billion plus, that is a rounding error. That came as a surprise because the United Nations, their projection is for China to peak its population size 15 years from now. And our own research with my colleagues, we thought this would come at 2025. So even surprised ourselves doing our own projections. Demographically, there are three reasons for this. One is there's an echo effect. That is, China has entered in the last number of years, 5-10 years, an era of smaller and smaller cohorts of young people of childbearing age or marriage age. To give you a sense of magnitude, at the peak of China's birth number of births back in the late 1980s, China was having 25 million births a year. So by the beginning of the 2000s, that number dropped to about 15 million. So the people born in the 90s, 80s, and even 2000s are now entering not just labor force age, but also marriage and childbearing age. So the number is getting smaller, and that's an echo effect of a demography. And the second one is more, I think, more interesting is, Alice, I think it's going to enlighten us more looking at Taiwan, is this sharp decrease in marriage or sharp increase in marriage age and fast postponement of the proportion of women or men who get married. To give you one number, we don't have the 2020 census number yet, but you're just looking at 2015, the mini census, between 1990 and the 2015, the share of women in urban China who were single back in 1990 was less than 5%. 2015, just in 25 years, it was close to 30%. Okay, so that's how fast this is moving. And looking at Taiwan, looking at South Korea, look at Japan, China is moving exactly that direction. So in Japan, 30% of men and close to 30% of women are still single, never married, at 35 to 39. That means they are never going to have children, right? So if China is moving in that direction, this is urban China only, okay. So that is another demographic force, but there are a lot of interpretations why this is happening, right? The third one is really, even for married couples, we talk a lot, that is those who did get married, they are not having many births. Again, there are many reasons for why people, young people, not having more than one child. So anyway, so those are the three demographic reasons for the, I would say, crashing low birth numbers in the recent years. Okay, so I should end there, and then we can come back to talk. Absolutely. Okay.
Thank you, Wang Feng. Alice, Taiwan is a prosperous, affluent country. Its birth levels seem eye-poppingly low and have been for a while. Tell us about what the Taiwan experience, what we should know about that if we want to put it into East Asian perspective also.
Well, I think one key issue leading to this very few births and very extremely low fertility rate is that there's still a very tight linkage between marriage and childbearing. So as Dr. Wang just mentioned, marriage rate is plunging. And so no marriages, no kids. Non-marital birth is still not very tolerated in all over East Asia. And of course, it has something to do with the patriarchal culture that really emphasizes female chastity. And then, you know, the face of the family, it's it's considered very disgraceful to a family if there's a non-marital birth. So what we're seeing with plunging birth rates and declining marriage rate is the rise of bridal pregnancies. So young couples rush into marriage after they find out that they're pregnant. And others, of course, aborted the kids. And, abortion is actually a black number that we really don't know how many children have been aborted. So that's one thing, this close linkage between marriage and childbirth. Another thing is this rapid and transition in terms of women's educational and occupational development. And so it's not the entire social milieu or parental generation is too slow to adapt to this rapid rise of women's status. And so when these younger generations of well-educated, economically independent women want to enter an intimate relationship, what they consider as ideal relationship is really different from a lot of men's perspective or the parental generation's perspective. And this really created some kind of conflict when they put that into their calculation and whether the quote-unquote marriage package is really worthwhile pursuing and the kind of opportunity cost they will have to face if they want to also have some kind of career development. So I think these are another two points I think I should point out, and it's common all across East Asia.
Thank you, Alice. Carl, what are the policy challenges that population change is posing to Beijing, to Taipei, to other governments? How well are they dealing with these?
Sure, great question, and it's an honor to be on the same panel with Alice and with Wang Feng. So I'm just going to mention one or two things about the policies that Chinese authorities have adopted. And the first is Chinese authorities themselves, I sense, are in somewhat of a panic. The results of the 2020 census, as Professor Wang Feng mentioned, seem to have caught them significantly by surprise. And they're now rapidly sort of readjusting what their projections are for China's population going forward. And it's much faster. As Professor Wang mentioned, you know, the things that they had been thinking would happen 10 or 15 years down the road are now happening now. And that, I think, is precisely behind the decision last summer to basically wipe out the entire private tutoring industry in China, precisely because they perceive the educational arms race as a disincentive to young families considering having children. And that just took place within a span of a couple of weeks. And more broadly, as Japan, Taiwan, and South Korea have all gone through their aging process, there comes a moment where authorities in each state start to think that the decline in births is a problem, and you begin to see them adopt a pronatalist strategy. This occurred in Japan in the early 90s. It took place in Taiwan and South Korea in the early 2000s. China is now in the process of beginning to work through what that might look like. So the first steps have been relaxing the curbs on births. So in 2016, the one-child policy was relaxed to a two-child policy. 2021, it was changed to a three-child policy. And at the most recent national meeting of the national legislature, the calls are to remove that entirely. That, as Professor Wang mentioned, isn't really having an effect. And you're starting to see Chinese local governments beginning to experiment with other things. Baby bonuses, loans for young parents seeking to have children, extending maternity or paternity, particularly maternity leave, to large numbers. I don't think any of that is going to have an effect on the underlying demographics for precisely the reasons that Professor Cheng mentioned, which is to say they can't shift the highly gendered social norms that are the blockage, which are preventing people from having children, from getting married. And so I don't think that the existing policies that they're beginning to grapple to are going to work. What worries me in the longer term is that the short term, twofold, the short term focus on trying to raise fertility targets is going to eat up a lot of time. And Chinese authorities aren't going to take measures to address latent systematic issues, pension reform, labor practices, which aging itself isn't a problem if you shift your society. But the problem is, I don't think Chinese authorities are taking steps on those more on those deeper system-wide issues. That's the first thing, and that sets them up for a more rocky transition later. The second problem I think they're going to run into is under Xi Jinping, the Chinese state is shifting to a more patriarchal, neo-traditionalist, authoritarian model. And I think that has real implications for gender relations and particularly sets them up to have a very rough and intrusive pronatalist campaign. Divorce applications in China are plunging. Used to be like 60% approval rate, now it's 40%. That's just in the span of a couple of years. I think it's a turn against divorce and a turn in a direction that's going to have significant implications for women and that will exacerbate some of the underlying problems. I'll stop there and I can follow up with more.
Thank you. I know we've got time for one more round of questions for our panel here. We'll see if we've got time for any fielder's choices after that. Wang Feng, the one-child policy, we've all heard of it. It had, in views of many, notorious human rights abuses. What about its demographic impact? Do we have any sense on what the actual impact on China's birth trends were? How different would China's population be today if nothing like this had ever been implemented? What's your sense on this? I know it's impossible exactly to answer, but what's your perspective?
I think this is one of the half knowns and half unknowns. I mean, there are certain knowns about what do we know about Chinese demography. The full effect of the one-child policy, it's not shown up yet, and I'll explain why. But first, go back to what would have happened had there not been the one-child policy. If you look, one thing for sure is that fertility would have continued to decline. And we saw that after what happened with the one-child policy being lifted, birth rate still goes down. And we saw what happened in other countries around China, and including not just Japan, South Korea, but also Thailand, which had almost exact the same fertility decline trajectory, and China now has a much higher per capita income than Thailand, right? And Iran, right? So you can see many other cases. So China, in a way, I think leadership, instead of pressing their feet or foot on the brakes, they push their foot on the gas pedal when fertility was going down, and then the policy dragged for so long. We're going to talk about COVID. What do you see, the way that COVID is being handled resembles a lot of what China did with the one-child policy, with the population control. So we don't know. What we do know is that it's over 35 years, a long time, and there are over probably 100 million families with only one child. So it has some effect on the population size and age structure. So aging is faster, but predominantly the reason that we don't know is what's gonna happen when the one child parent generation's parents grow not in their 60s or 70s, but when they become 80 or even older. So there's going to be tremendous strain on both sides, for the very old parents and also for the young, for their children, right? And that is also perhaps, we don't know the exact fact, why a lot of the young only child generation, they're not having two children. You know, some would think, you know, if they were growing up as only one child, they would want their child to have a sibling. And that's not quite the case because of the many other concerns, right? Labor market, education, housing, career, but also caring for their aging parents. So that caused it's not easily calculable in terms of economics. And so we're going to see what's going to happen. Yeah.
Alice, given the enormous difference in scale between Taiwan and the PRC, immigration has at least the possibility of being a compensatory factor for Taiwan, import from abroad, so to speak. What's been Taiwan's experience with immigration, with multicultural families? What do you evaluate the opportunities of immigration to be for Taiwan?
I think it's not just Taiwan, but the entire East Asia is the so-called replacement migration that has been adopted by many European countries is really not on the table. For one thing, the entire region is pretty xenophobic. I'm very sorry to have to say that. So what we're seeing now is that, especially in Taiwan, the lower SES men, also in Japan and Korea, they are trying to look for bride or women who can help them continue their family lineage to bear children for them from nearby Southeast or Southern Asian countries, such as Vietnam, Indonesia. And for Taiwan, because of the language and cultural similarity, men are also looking for wife from mainland China. But these are largely lower SES men. So when these migrant women marry into these socially disadvantaged families, their sort of aspirations, you know, moving to a more developed, potentially more gender egalitarian society becomes clear to them that it's not the case that they, it's not really what they expected, because these are actually the kind of families that tend to be more patriarchal because of their social status. So what we're seeing is that the completed fertility rates of these foreign brides in Taiwan and also in Japan and Korea are actually lower than local women with similar education. And if you control for the spousal age gap, it's still the foreign brides did not bear more children than local women. So is it really a solution to this low fertility dilemma in Taiwan? I don't think so. But without these foreign brides, we would only have even fewer babies. That's what I can say at this point. I think this is something that's very difficult. And in terms of the outcome, child outcome of these second generation new Taiwanese kids, they are growing up in families in lower class, and also they're facing some discriminatory treatment due to their mother's lower education, and also because of the community they grow up is not so much advantage compared to other Taiwanese children. So how they're adapting to the entire situation remains to be better studied, and we don't have good research.
Thank you, Alice. Carl, family in East Asia, in China and the rest of East Asia, it's been the extended family has been the social safety net when times are bad. It's been the springboard for opportunity when times are good. That extended family system is withering before our eyes everywhere. In China in particular, to what degree can rule of law, strengthening of legal institutions compensate for what we're seeing? And any thoughts you have about the rest of the area?
Just on that question of like what supplements or what as the extended family declines, what takes its place? I'm going to build on something that Alice just brought up, which is to say the population flows from overseas. And first talk about South Korea, Japan, and Taiwan. So as Alice mentioned, Professor Cheng, one of the key things that's happened in all three of those countries as societies have aged is you've seen an influx of people from overseas. There's been a small number of people who have married in, and as Professor Cheng mentioned, one source is, you know, it's local Korean governments giving government money for elderly Korean men in rural areas to go to Vietnam to find brides. That's one flow. But there's another flow as well, which is short-term, sometimes it's a year or 2 years, but people who are coming on contract work. These are Vietnamese construction workers who are helping, who are working on construction projects in Taiwan. It's Indonesian and Filipino nannies who are coming to Taiwan, but also South Korea and Japan, to help take care of the elderly. And so that's a core element of this is a population flow. You can't call it immigration, whatever. I mean, but it's people who are moving, and the number is not small. It's about, in Taiwan and South Korea, that's about, could be 3 to 5% of the population right now is composed of those individuals in addition to the people who have married in. One of the questions for China going forward, as it goes into the very rapid aging, is what happens? And particularly, you know, who takes care of the elderly? In my own research that I'm working on, that's a big question that I have, because it's, of course, right now in Taiwan, China, nothing like that exists. You don't even see, not particularly with the COVID policies, but even beforehand, it's almost non-existent. And so that, I think, is an important thing to watch, is those flows of population.
I think I have time for just one more question for the group, but I'd like to get lightning round responses, if I could, from you. I'd be fired as the moderator if I didn't ask this. What is going on in East Asia with these crazy low birth rates? We're talking about almost 50% below replacement in places like South Korea and places like Taiwan, heading down towards those levels in many parts of mainland China. I mean, this is much lower than sub-replacement fertility in West Europe. And there was this guy called Confucius, I think, who had this idea about how the harmonious continuation of society had to do with continuing the family lineage through the male issue. So why are we seeing this of all places in the world in East Asia? I'd like to ask you first, Alice, for a lightning round Rorschach test response.
Okay. You mean why so few babies and marriages?
Why is fertility so especially low in Taiwan, South Korea, now in China, much lower than in West Europe, North America, other areas?
Well, from my own observation, there's basically something going on in the marriage market. So everyone's postponing marriage to much later ages. But with this strong idea of continuing the family lineage, women's age becomes an issue once they enter into their mid-30s. And that's when quite a bit of women start thinking, oh, my career has stabled and I have, you know, it's good time to start looking for a marriage partner. But then men, on the other hand, they're thinking, oh, I should, you know, at the same age range, they're thinking, I need to find a lady who is more fecund, quote unquote. Because, you know, these public health and medical doctors keep telling you the golden ages of having babies between 28 and 34, but nobody's marrying at that age in Taiwan. You know, the never married percentage for 25 to 29 year old is 96%. For 30 to 34, there's still 62 or 65% not marrying a man, and 58 for women. So what are you talking about? You're telling half of the marriage people at marriageable age that, oh, you are, especially women, you are approaching the end of your reproductive career. But the really paradoxical thing is that in the age of very low fertility, we actually enter also into a period of the highest number of women mothers, 40 plus, you know, age 40 plus. So back in 1975, when total fertility rate was really high, you know, there are fewer than 1,000 mothers who had their children when they're more than 40 years old. But, you know, in 2021, there are more than 10,000, yet TFR is only 0.99 in Taiwan. So it's this thing that, you know, people are postponing it. to later ages, but the society, the social value and everything is you know, remain, you know, unchanged for like three decades and still telling you, oh, the proper age to do so and so is at this age. But it's, so there's a disjuncture between reality and expectation, and I think that's something that is not discussed enough.
Thank you.
You know, marital age preference.
Can I add something?
Yes, I was going to ask the gentleman if they have any quick additions.
Well, the gentleman would go after the other gentleman. That's by the name you brought up, Confucius. There are three regions in the world with very, very low fertility. East Asia is one of them, but not only one. The other two are Europe and South Europe. Now, there's something in common between, well, leaving Eastern Europe aside. We know what's happening right now. That could be a reason. Both for Southern Europe and Eastern Asia, they share one common, not quite value, but one cultural inclination. That's big families, right? So you see in big family areas, they have low fertility. Now, there are other cultural traditions for Southern Europe, but for East Asia, it's Confucius. That is, the parents need to be responsible for your children. It's not just you have many children. You have to raise your children. Many Chinese parents want their children to have better life than themselves. So Chinese parents, as taught by Confucius, love their children too much. The way you love your children is not have them.
I'm going to follow and just echo everything I'm about to say as just things that when I was in Taiwan talking to Professor Cheng, I'm like, so that also Confucius is a Confucius man, and there's another key element, which is what's the responsibility of the women? The women is to take care of the children, and the women to take care of the elderly in-laws. And so that you're having large numbers of Chinese women who are basically, or Taiwanese women, saying, you know, basically, this is not what I want to do. Moreover, just as Professor Cheng had mentioned, you got to also understand that there's no outlet of what if I don't want to get married. What's the ability to have? Can I still have children? In Iceland, I think the statistics Professor Cheng had given me was 80% of all births take place out of marriage. In the United States, it's 40%. In Taiwan, it's like 1%.
3.8.
In Taiwan. But in Japan and South Korea, it's
very low. Virtually.
2%.
2%. Yeah. Right. So it's basically, this is just, those gender norms. And then, there was the other statistic was in Japan and South Sweden both have the best childcare policies in the world. Paternity leave, 80 or 90% of Swedish fathers take it, only 7% of Japanese fathers do. So there are gendered stuff that's going on that are leading women to not get married and not have children. And you address those or you don't solve the problem.
Thank you. Well, at this time, I'd like to invite members to join our conversations with their questions. Please remember this is on the record. Yes. Let's start with the lady here, please.
Joan Kaufman.
Yes, please.
Thank you. I'm Joan Kaufman from the Schwarzman Scholars Program. And my question really is, invoking Confucius again in the male lineage. What impact of the male preference, son preference, and sex selective abortion and all the missing women on, exacerbating the low fertility problem in China, the less babies. Because if you have less women having babies, you're just going to have less kids altogether, right? So could you comment on that? I know I've brought this up before, Wang Feng, but I'd really curious to hear whether you think that's a real impact.
Largely because of the one-child policy, China had abnormal sex ratio, elevated sex ratio for 2.5 decades. Normal sex ratio is about 105 boys to 100 girls, and China had a sex ratio as high as 124 in the early 2000s. So for decades. So depending on the estimate, because a lot of the girls were hidden, not reported, but the number could be 20 to 40 meaning or so-called missing girls, mostly through sex selective abortion. So that, of course, is going to have some effect. But demographically, because this really runs through 30-some years, so it's not like China has 40 or 30 million young men who are all in their reproductive age. It's spreading out through a large age range. So it would have certain effect. But I actually want to bring this up, which is when we talk about migration. This is not a migration. This is trafficking and taking hostage of women. While Winter Olympics was going on in Beijing, the social media was more focused on this woman who was basically bought and sold and chained and had 8 children, right? So the Chinese social media had explosive discussion of this, not about the husband, not about a woman, but about the responsibilities of various levels of government and the Chinese birth control policy. So again, I think for people here who report on China, you never know what is the fuse that's going to lead to this discussion. Anyway, so I just want to bring that up. You're not importing from, there's a lot of actually border marriages in China as well, but this particular case is really internal, right?
Thank you. We have a question from our virtual audience.
Our first virtual question will be from George Breslauer.
Thank you very much. This has been a very interesting discussion. I have a question about the economic implications of this demographic profile. In the United States, when we talk about self-driving trucks, we talk about 3 to 4 million truck drivers prospectively being unemployed. To what extent can technology compensate for a declining workforce in East Asia?
I'll take a crack at that. I mean, I think that's a really good question. That's one that I'm kind of working out in my mind as well. And my reference point is really to look at what's happening already in South Korea, Japan, and Taiwan. So, these are societies, I think Japan, robots, and that certainly is one response, is to begin to begin to rely more heavily on mechanization to sort of take the place of certain types of jobs. That has not fully solved the issue in any of these societies. So, like I said, the statistics in Taiwan and South Korea are just off the top of my head, but it's about 4 to 5% of the population consists of people who are sort of not born in those areas, and have come, and that includes people who were married in, but the larger proportion is people who are working on these short-term labor contracts. And some of it is blue-collar jobs, it's heavy construction and the like, but another component is actually it's elder care. And so it is Indonesian, Filipino nannies who are taking care not anymore of children, but of 80 or 90-year-old. That strikes me as a very difficult thing to rely on any sort of technology to address. And so that's a particular segment within China that I'm trying to figure out how do you address that, particularly the answer in Shanghai or Beijing is, of course, you will have people moving from rural areas to urban areas. But the question is, what happens in the rural areas? And in Taiwan, even in rural areas, you can find foreign labor who is helping to take care of the elderly grandparent. I don't know what happens in China.
Questions from the audience. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Michelle Caruso Cabrera. Could you explain a little bit more about why the elimination of private tutors should lead to more babies?
Oh, that's a theory. That's the government's when.
What is their thinking?
The thinking is that high education costs, arms race, just kind of like people in New York. Think of the amount of money that flows into what's the burden involved in educating a child. And from the standpoint of the Chinese government, what Xi Jinping was thinking is if we can sort of begin to eradicate those barriers, make it cheaper, make the whole concept of it's not such a burden to have a child, if we're able to sort of take down the cost of education, that will encourage more young people to have babies. That's the theory, at least.
Yes, in the back, please.
Mark Rosen. I would be interested to hear the panel's views on whether they think a lower birth rate, particularly for China, is positive or negative. There are some economists, Adair Turner, for example, wrote not so long ago a piece where he actually strongly argued that, in fact, it was positive for China that there should be a declining birth rate. I think for the other countries, it's more difficult to argue that. For South Korea, Taiwan, et cetera, who've got much smaller populations. But for China, it seems to me that it's not necessarily a bad thing, but I'd be interested to hear what the panel's views are.
Can I ask all of our panelists if they wish to respond to this? Maybe.
I can start it. Let's put this into perspective population growth and the decline is not something that we actually can do a lot about. Now, for many people in this room, myself included, we remember the time when controlling population, birth control, was the global agenda as climate change right now, 50 years ago, 40 years ago. 50 years ago, the world was growing, population was growing at 2% per year. That rate, the world population would double every 30-some years, right? Last year, the growth rate is 1%. 50 years from now, the growth rate will be zero. So you are going to have this growth and decline, just as we did not expect the world population would have such explosion. It was largely driven by mortality decline, improvement in well-being, life expectancy. Good things happened. And now we did not expect the world would go into such, you know, a fertility decline, birth rate decline, population decline. So these are forces I think are really beyond my, you know, comprehension per se. But one thing important to point out is that the pollution, the resources use, and all those kind of environmental issues, they are more caused by way of life, by our behavior, not by just number per se. So that was argument used in China 30 or 40 years ago for the one-child policy. Now we've seen population is declining in China. I mean, the birth rate is declining in China. Birth rate number is going down, but the pollution went way, way, way up. And we all know that's not caused by number, is caused by the way of living, right? So that's...
Alice and Carl, anything to add?
I'll have a very short one-sentence response to that. The positive side of I see for low fertility is that if we think about the past traditional high fertility is sustained by sacrificing women's education and education rights and career prospect, then I think low fertility is probably not a bad thing because now women get to be more autonomous to pursue their own life as they wish.
Carl? Also give a one sentence, one short thing. I'll say, you know, population aging or decline is not in itself a problem. It's whether or not you address all of the issues that are associated with it, such as changing your pension practices, say, figuring out what you're going to do in terms of elder care. It's the key isn't the aging itself or the decline in the birth. It's how do you adjust the effects that that come naturally with it.
Thank you. We have a question from our virtual audience.
Our next virtual question will be from Herman Cohen.
Thank you for a very interesting discussion. I'm a retired U.S. diplomat who specialized in Africa. And I'm seeing over the last 20 years a growing number of Chinese people settling in Africa through the Belt and Road Initiative and that sort of thing. So the question is there significant emigration from China these days?
I'll take that. I mean, there is that trend that you noticed, yes. And in fact, I'm not a specialist on Africa, but yes, I believe there are about 1 to 2 million Chinese who are in Africa, some with large state-owned projects, some also people who have just decided, I'm going to make my future in Gambia opening a store. And so that is an interesting side of population that we don't think about. I'll flag one other element as well. which is those same population trends happened, for example, with respect to Taiwan in Southeast Asia, which was, you know, when Taiwanese industry and went to Southeast Asia and went to China as well, you also saw those population flows. One of the things that also happened was that also created the backflow, which is to say, those people sometimes married folks from Southeast Asia or were working with people who then ended up coming back into the home country, Korea, Japan, Taiwan, for work. One thing I think it's worth watching is, does China start to experience that? Average age in Africa is 19, sub-Saharan Africa. Average age in China is closing in on 40. So if you're thinking about elder care, if you're thinking about where does young people come from, there's one big one in my mind that I'm thinking of, and that starts to create some really interesting questions politically about Chinese identity and the ability of people to enter.
Questions? Yes, sir. Yes.
Professor Wang mentioned with one of the studies, Ed Cox, Patterson-Belknap, you mentioned in urban areas, which raises the issue of the two populations in China separated by a registration system. Is there all the issues we're discussing? Is it different in rural areas than it is in urban areas in China?
Well, we have... Scott here, Roselle, this afternoon, and I think he will address this. The one area I did not get into is China not only faces a population challenge, but more seriously is this urban-rural, the urbanization challenge. China still has 260 million people as of last census who are in cities but without local household registration. Now, China has relaxed over time the hukou, the household registration restriction. But still, for very large cities, for 5 million and more, you still cannot just get a household registration to enjoy the local benefits. And those China has 19 cities with 5 million or more, and they account for 210 million migrants without benefits. So how would China deal with this when the economy is slowing down, government revenue increase is slowing down, and you still have so many Chinese migrants in the cities and who do not have the local benefits? So that is just one of the issues that's, you know, demographically related to migration, urbanization, but it's going to be one of the huge challenges China would face.
We have another virtual question.
Our next virtual question will be from Paul Vandenbroek.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Paul Vandenbroek. I'm with Pfizer and also the World Demographic and Aging Forum. Quick question related to, given the demographic changes that you've described, what specific changes, if any, would there be in healthcare policy priorities for the government to deal with this from a both from priorities for the younger part of the population as well as then the over 65?
All of our speakers may have something to say on that.
Alice,
would you want to begin?
What's happening?
I want to speak louder.
Alice, I think all of our speakers may have something to say about this. Would you like to start?
Well, of course, because of this population aging process and phenomenon, I think the government of Taiwan is thinking about how we need to really allocate more resources to this long-term care for the elderly population. And that I think that's a main concern for all these aging East Asian countries. In terms of younger population, I don't see anything particular. Another thing is this assisted reproductive technology has recently been opened up to all married couples. In the past, before July last year, it was only available, fully subsidized by the government to low-income couples. And then, you know, policymakers and a lot of scholars are pushing and really saying that this is not reasonable. So it opened up to all married couple, but you see married couple. So there's a very strong, you know, value put there that, you know, only married people are eligible to use that. Yeah, that's my quick comment.
Thank you. Carl?
Well, just on that, that point I put, that's an issue in China, too. I mean, so both sort of, and this is an interesting question for, I think, for Xi Jinping. On the one hand, if you're interested in sort of bumping up your, so IVF, right, still limited, not available to single women, and there are lots of debates online about this. But yes, I mean, if you have a highly heteronormative, patriarchal system, do you want to start opening up IVF practices to single women? And you could almost think from the standpoint of the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, it could go a couple of different ways. I just have the feeling that fundamentally this starts to challenge the direction that Xi Jinping wants to take the country. So I'm sort of betting that it doesn't open up. It's going to be within the same rubric that Professor Cheng mentioned. It's only for married couples.
Wang Feng, any comments?
Well, it's another the most complicated story and the challenge of the Chinese healthcare sector. There are two sectors in China that are probably the most entrenched and still in the planned economy mode. One is education, and that's how they were able to get rid of the tutoring system. The Ministry of Education was behind this. They really worried about losing their power, losing their good teachers to these private tutoring businesses. So they've been pushing this for the longest time, and now with low fertility, they came out and then somehow allowed the government just to ban this overnight, and resulting in tens of millions of young people's unemployment. The other, we can see the same thing for the health sector. The Chinese health sector reform has been very slow, and in terms of equal access, cost, quality, I would say all three areas are failing. Here we have expert, Dr. Huang here. And so again, I think that's also a challenge China is going to have to deal with in the years to come. Just to give you this number, per capita income doubled, I think, in the decades of the 2000, and the per capita health cost increased at twice that much. So with aging population, you can expect that continue to go up. Associated with the segmented society, you have healthcare that is highly unequal among different segments of the population. So that's associated with urbanization, unfinished urbanization. So those kind of issues, I think, with healthcare, the cost is driven by aging, that's clearly. So that's going to be another issue, I think, this afternoon people can talk more about.
We're getting towards the witching hour, but see, I think we have time for certainly one more question. Ambassador Hauser.
What a fascinating discussion. I want to ask perhaps an absurd question, but China used great coercion in the one family policy. They used coercion in the lockdown. Is it conceivable that they would concoct a coercion to have children? That happened in Nazi Germany. It wasn't wildly successful, but it had some measure of producing more Aryan-type children. Is that something that you think might be on the horizon?
I can try to take a crack at this. I mean, I am sort of thinking about this. My nightmare scenarios don't yet involve like breeding centers or anything like that. I mean, what I really start to imagine is fertility and marriage targets start getting baked into cadre evaluation systems used to evaluate local party officials in exactly the same way they were under the one-child policy, but the numbers are just reversed. During the 80s and 90s, you wanted to keep the birth rates low, so you would evaluate local officials and whether or not you had hit your target for X number of, and that led to a whole range of coercive practices, some forced abortion, also just high use of coercive fines to push people in particular directions. If I really worry about what might happen, my image is that it gets flipped. And of course, what that means in practice could be, if you're told that we should have a total fertility rate of X within our jurisdiction, it could lead different people to do different things. Some, it's like, we're going to organize like lots of marriage, you know, lots of, you know, dating stuff for young singles. But other people might say, well, in order to make target before I go up, try to get boosted up to like, you know, provincial or, you know, county head, I'm gonna sort of drop abortion availability within my jurisdiction so that I produce a bump in numbers. Or maybe I'm going to, you know, I don't know. But that's, and then you do start to worry about coercion, because what about just putting the arm on the courts to sort of not grant divorces or to overlook domestic violence as a reason for divorce? You could end up with, you know, even without the whole breeding camp idea, you could just end up with a whole bunch of bad stuff happening, and it would be extremely detrimental for women and for Chinese society. So.
Anything could be possible, we learned, but this is one thing that I think is highly unlikely. And if I were to advise the Chinese leadership, I would say, do not touch this bomb, because they, by announcing the three-child policy, they already made themselves a laughingstock. You know, you saw blogging people saying, oh, I got a quota for Maserati, but I'm not using it. If the government is going down further along this line, they're really going to, I think, get an unexpected revolution, and that revolution comes from young, educated Chinese women. And that, we already saw that earlier this year with this, you know, this kidnapped and chained woman. So I would tell the Chinese leadership, don't touch this.
Alice, Wang Feng, Carl, a single parting thought you'd like to leave with our audience. We have just 2 minutes left.
Any thoughts?
Alice, would you begin by offering us a single parting thought you'd like the audience to hear, to think about?
I think everyone here should really think about the future of China. It's a big population, and the future of it, it's not just the future of the Chinese people. It will shape and change world order, economy, and everything. So it's very important that we pay close attention to its development.
Thank you. Carl?
I reiterate what Alice, I think this is the single most important thing for China going forward. It really should learn from the experiences of Taiwan, Japan, and South Korea, and rather than undertake some sort of military intervention along the lines of what sort of, you know, Russia is doing, realize that sort of addressing this particular issue is far more important to the future peace and prosperity of China than anything else.
I think China needs to start getting people psychologically ready to accept the fact that China is going to have continued population decline. And then within 5 years, it's going to be smaller than India. And that's not important demographically, but I think psychologically is something that is going to happen.
Thank you. Well, in terms of housekeeping, please join us for session two, starting in 15 minutes, the forever lockdown, COVID-19, and the closing of China. But I'd like you to thank our panelists for their splendid presentations, especially Alice, who is joining us from the middle of the night from Taiwan. So thank you all, ladies and gentlemen. Okay.